My name is Mark Mazur. I'm the Robert C. Posen Director of the Urban Brookings Tax Policy Center. I've been at the Tax Policy Center now for just over 2 months, and it really is a great pleasure to be here with you all today. The Lubick Symposium was created to honor the extraordinary record of Don Lubick. He's a very special kind of public servant. In his service at the Department of Treasury, he was Tax Legislative Counsel, Deputy Assistant Secretary for Tax Policy, and Assistant Secretary twice. And throughout it all, Don Lubick was dedicated to promoting the cause of a better tax system. He boiled this down to his adherence to three principles: efficiency, equity, and simplicity. And Don Lubick was a model to some. He was a mentor to some and a great colleague to others. And it's really a tribute to, it's a real tribute to him that the tax community honors him with this symposium. Don wanted to be here today, but he had an accident that injured his foot, and so he's unable to show up here. He's out of commission for a few weeks, but Joe Guntag wanted to say a few words on behalf of Don.
Thank you, Mark. I'm Joe Guttentag. Don sent me a note and asked me to read it to you. Dear friends, I'm sorry not to be with you physically, though I'm connected through a link. Unfortunately, I broke my ankle on Tuesday and forced to recuperate at home. I will really miss being present in person because the topic is one of great interest and importance, and one we in tax policy world treat more marginally than warranted. I am grateful for associating my name with this second annual event. I hope it is not to honor my contributions. They only result from the many lawyers and economists more capable than I who made my stays at the Office of Tax Policy the most capable operation I could ever have dreamed of being a part. One thing, however, leads me to be happy with associating my name to this program. That is my desire to proclaim to tax experts and the taxpaying public the contribution of the Tax Policy Center to the enlightenment it furnishes to the tax world, the governments, federal and state, and the public. It does this by furnishing impartial and thoroughly accurate data and analysis necessary in the making of tax policy that, to the extent possible, can combine the past to simplicity, equity, and economic growth.
So we got a little address from Don Lubick here. Thanks for that. I know you're watching on the webcast. And thanks for all you've done for tax policy in general. There's a couple housekeeping items that I want to mention today. One is we really encourage audience participation. So during the Q&A portion today, there'll be folks going around with microphones. You should all feel free to grab one and ask a question or make a comment. Similarly, for folks who are on the webcast, watching on the webcast, you can connect with us via Twitter using the hashtag TaxFacts. I think that about covers the housekeeping portions for today. So let me introduce our keynote speaker, Vanessa Williamson. She's a fellow in governance studies at Brookings Institution. Vanessa's been studying perceptions of the tax system for several years, recently released a book titled Read My Lips, Why Americans Are Proud to Pay Taxes, and also just conducted a survey quiz in conjunction with Vox.com that generated some interesting data that she'll share with us today. Personally, I find this topic fascinating. Paying taxes is an annual ritual that pretty much every household in America goes through. Way more people pay taxes than vote. And so it's one of the few things that, as a country, we share and it kind of knits us together. And so having Vanessa here to talk about that, really, I was just delighted by that, and looking forward to having her help shed some light on these important issues and relationships. So please join me in welcoming Vanessa Williamson here today.
Thank you all for having me today. So I'm really looking forward to talking to you a little bit, both about my new research and some work I've been doing before that, on the question of tax fairness, right? So the question I want to talk to you about is this one: what makes taxes seem fair, right? To members of the general public, as opposed to, say, let's say, tax policy professionals and experts like folks in this room. But as a general rule, you know, there are several reasons to think this question is important. You might want, for instance, people to feel good about the taxpaying process for reasons of fiscal sustainability, right? It would be great if taxpaying were not such a controversial issue that the federal government and states and cities see large fluctuations in their budget as taxes become very controversial and you have sudden shifts in tax rates or base. You might also think it's an important question, just because, you know, at the end of the day, wouldn't you like it to be the case that people living in a democracy are relatively happy about the public policies that affect them, as taxes certainly do? And then finally, to the extent that you think of taxes as attitudes about taxes as a kind of referendum on government, right, because this is the money people are chipping in to make that government run, so people's attitudes about that, whether that expense is worth paying or whether that money's being used well or whether it's being collected fairly, these are questions you might think are just important from a perspective of democratic accountability, right? So this is a question I think a lot about, and I think about it in two parts. The first one is, what values do Americans want to see guiding tax policy, right? What do they think are the principles that would make tax policy seem fair? For instance, do they think that taxes should be progressive? Do they think rich people should pay a larger percentage, not just a larger amount, right? Or do you think, another way of thinking about that, you might say, do you think we should be putting taxes on things that we don't like cigarettes or alcohol, something like that, so that what taxes really are a way to limit behavior that we disapprove of, right? So are those values that people want to see implemented, or which values do people want to see implemented in their tax policy? The other question, of course, is what facts about tax policy do people actually have to work with when they're making evaluations of public policy, right? And I think this is, of course, on an issue like taxation, which is so complicated, a really difficult barrier between people's values and their policy preferences, right? It's sometimes hard for people to see which policies would actually implement the values, even if they're clear about what principles they think should guide tax policy. So one way to think about a value that might guide tax policy is a very common one when we talk professionally about tax policy, is a benefit principle, right? And this is the idea that one's tax costs should be more or less equal and ideally less than the benefits one receives from government, right? Now, there's some theoretical issues with a sort of actually evaluating whether you're getting value for your money in sort of a consumer perspective, right? And two of them I'll just talk briefly about. First of all, obviously, when taxes pay for public goods, things like roads and clean air and clean water, and, you know, I think it's reasonable to think that that's hard to value, and it's particularly, I'd imagine, hard for average people busy with their lives to think about how to value those kinds of things. And secondly, of course, and this is the sort of, you know, conundrum in taxation, the tax system, one of the things it provides is the money that operates our legal system, which protects property rights. So you get a little recursion problem, right? When you're thinking about the value of taxes, one of the things it does is protect the total property that you have. So without the taxes, how much of that property would you maintain, you know, if you really imagined no taxes at all? So there's a little recursion problem, a little turtles all the way down problem when you're thinking about a benefit principle of taxation. But this is a very common way to think about taxes, right? Like, the same way I buy something at the store, am I getting value for my money? Am I getting value for my taxes? Okay. So there's been some research on this question, and the evidence, I think, is mixed in terms of to what extent we can identify people using a benefit principle to evaluate their taxes. Sometimes it seems to be pretty clearly there in the data, and sometimes it's not. So there are two examples that I think have gotten a little bit of attention. One is the idea of a federal tax receipt. The White House ran something kind of like this on their website for a long time. You could see, you put in the amount that you pay in taxes, and it spits out the federal budget that shows you, you know, approximately where each of those dollars would went if it was split evenly across the federal budget. There have been some experiments done to see what effect that has on people's attitudes, either their knowledge, first of all, about what government does, or their attitudes about whether they think their taxes are used well. And there have been really very limited results, even on the knowledge portion of that. So that hasn't been a huge success, but maybe, you know, it just needs to be done better. That's always possible. You need to present information more clearly. That could be one of the limitations. Where you've seen, I think, some real success is in Social Security receipts. Some of you may remember at one point receiving a green piece of paper that told you about the, you know, the contributions you'd made to the Social Security Fund and what benefits you were likely to receive when you retired. And so one of the neat things about that, and some of you may already know this, that was rolled out as a randomized experiment so you could really measure what it did for people's knowledge of Social Security. And they found that those sort of receipts both increased people's knowledge about the Social Security program, how it works, and their own benefits, but also their confidence in the system. So that was a real win, right? So when it comes comes to thinking about a benefit principle, there's some evidence that you can have an impact that way. But there's another way of thinking about taxes, which is actually more of what my work is on. And I think sometimes, you know, of course, because it's my work, I think, you know, more people should think of things this way. And that value is ethical reciprocity, right? And this is an idea that Margaret Levy talks a lot about, but it's the idea that you're willing to do your part, your sort of civic duty, when you think other people are also chipping in a fair share, right? So this treats tax paying less like a consumer interaction, where you're like looking at the cost of the car and deciding whether it's worth it to you to buy, and more like something like military service, right? So that you're thinking, well, you know, there's this big task that we as a country need to do, I'll do my part, but if I see everyone else skipping out, maybe I'll free ride too, right? So it's sort of the collective action free rider problem more than the sort of basic straightforward consumer interaction, individualized consumer interaction. Now, there's some evidence in the tax compliance literature that this matters, right? If you look cross-nationally, there's a relationship, certainly, between people's sense of tax morale and the level of compliance in the country, although, of course, the withholding system and the enforcement of the IRS are also, of course, critically important to tax compliance. But there is some evidence that tax morale matters, too, that your sense that this is a civic norm, that this is a social norm we all share, that we're going to do our part and pay taxes, to the extent that that is agreed upon by the sort of population of the country, it does help predict a little bit what actual tax compliance we see. And in the United States, tax morale is very high, right? Americans are exceptionally committed to the idea that taxpaying is a civic duty. And this is just, this on the bottom you can see it's about 40 years of survey data going back to the early 80s, and the y-axis is just the percentage of respondents who agree or disagree with the statement. And this is, it gets asked in a lot of different surveys in a lot of different ways, but these are all questions about the civic duty of taxpaying. So, for instance, the little line of D's at the top are the idea, whether you agree with that it's every American's civic duty to pay their fair share of taxes, right? And then some of the others are phrased in the opposite form, so they're saying, you know, the government wastes a lot of money, so it's not really that bad to hold back a little on your taxes, right? This is the percentage of people who disagree with that statement. And what you find is, I mean, first of all, real consistency over 40 years, across question wordings, across survey firms, and also very, very high agreement, right? So 80 and 90% of people agreeing with the idea that taxpaying is an important civic duty. No, it's not okay to hold back, even if I give you kind of an excuse in the question. So this idea, if we think of taxpaying as a civic duty, more like military service, it's a little bit of evidence that maybe ethical reciprocity, this idea, I'll chip in if you chip in, is underlying people's tax attitudes, or it might be worth trying to look at. Another piece of data that suggests that ethical reciprocity might be a way to think about tax fairness is this question. This question gets asked very regularly. This happens to be a Pew question from 2015. And they asked, what bothers you the most about taxes? Now, in the full sample, about 14% said nothing bothered them a lot about taxes, so they got dropped. This is among the 86% of people who were bothered a lot by at least something. And you'll see, it's probably a little hard to read because the screen's divided, but the two big columns on the left say the feeling that corporations don't pay their share, and then the feeling that the wealthy don't pay their fair share, right? And then the amount you actually pay in taxes is the fourth column. Only about 8% of respondents thought that the amount that they actually personally paid in taxes was the thing that really bothered them about taxes, right? And then you'll see the last column that I want to sort of draw your attention to is the 5%, which is just to the right of the amount you pay, is the feeling that poor people aren't paying your fair share. So if you ask people what bothers them most about taxes, the thing that really motivates a lot of people is about two-thirds of respondents in total is the idea that someone else isn't chipping in, right? So it suggests to me that we should think a little more about this possibility that ethical reciprocity or, you know, is everyone else doing their part is an important part of people's considerations, not just the benefits they get from government. Okay. So that was the values section. Now let's talk about the facts. Of course, this is hard, right? Tax policy is hard, or else we would not all have jobs working on that kind of question, right? And it's very common for people to have misconceptions about the tax code, and in particular, in my research, I think people have a huge limitation in their understanding of how different taxes affect Americans across the income distribution, right? So I'll talk about two reasons you see that. One thing is that people tend to confuse hassle with cost, so the federal income tax is a lot of hassle, but it is not a lot of cost to most Americans, certainly the bottom half of the income distribution. But that bottom half of the income distribution feels just as hassled by the income tax process as everyone else, right? So there tends to be a confusion there. So people focus on the income tax, the federal income tax, a little more than would really make sense if they were just thinking about which taxes cost them the most, because the payroll tax and the sales tax are very expensive for a lot of people in the lower half of the income spectrum. And then, of course, the federal income tax is very politically prominent as well, right? So you've got both the daily experiential thing drawing your attention to the federal income tax, the sort of tax season, right? And then alongside that, of course, the federal income tax is the thing that people on TV and politicians talk about a lot more than, at least at a national level, than all the other taxes that people pay. So I'll just give you one specific example of how the experience of tax paying can mislead people about how the income distribution is affected by a particular tax. So on the sales tax, there's a substantial percentage of people who misunderstand the sales tax as a progressive tax, when in fact it typically, not that it can't be a progressive tax, but typically in the United States it is not. It falls more heavily on low-income people than high-income people. But if you ask people about how the sales tax affects people at different income levels, if you're not, lower-income people know that it's very expensive to them personally, unsurprisingly. They're watching their pennies at the register. But once you're in the middle class or above, you don't really think about the sales tax. Doesn't feel very prominent. An extra dollar here, two here or there doesn't really matter. Except when you buy something expensive, if you bought a really fancy pair of shoes, if you bought a computer, if you bought a car, then suddenly 7% sales tax, wow, is that a big number, right? So because people have this experience, it's common for people when they're trying to figure out, and this I found through open-ended surveys and also through interviews, when they're trying to think through, okay, I've never really thought about who pays a lot in sales tax. Well, it was expensive to me when I bought something expensive, so it must be expensive to the wealthy, right? And now that's not a failure of basic math, right, which is reassuring. It's not an enumeracy problem. It's a failure to recognize that consumption and income don't scale together, right, that as you become more high earning, you consume less of your income and you save more, basically, right? But that people don't recognize that basic reality, and so they misunderstand the impact of the sales tax. All right. So there are these mistakes people have that make it hard for them to identify what policies they should support given their values. So if you think that the sales tax falls heavily on the wealthy and you think the wealthy should pay more, which is a common thing to believe, then you're likely to think a national sales tax might be the way to go to make sure that the wealthy people pay their share. When in fact, it would be quite likely that such a policy would do the opposite of what you wanted to see. Okay. So I'm interested in this question of, if you give people facts, does it change their attitudes about fairness? Okay? And so the Tax Policy Center has worked with Vox in the past, and we were chatting about, oh, do you want to do like a tax policy quiz for tax day? Wouldn't that be fun? And I thought to myself, why don't we put an experiment in there? Right? Because then you don't just find out the overall answers of what do people who go to the Vox website know about taxes, but you also get a little bit of information about how people like Vox viewers, our readers, would feel differently if they had different information, right? So we worked with Vox to do an online quiz that it contained in it an experiment, and I'll explain how that worked in a second. It would have looked like this if you went to the website. You got to place what looks a little bit like Tax Jeopardy, right? And here's how the experiment actually worked. Every participant answered 4 fact questions and 4 opinion questions, right? But not everyone got the same questions, right? And so we specifically set up the questions to draw your attention to different parts of the tax code, and I'll show you that in a minute. So people were randomly assigned, which is the crucial part of this, right? So they're similar on average, except for the fact that they got a different set of questions at random, to 1 of 5 groups. Either the control group, right, which is the people who answered the opinion questions first, meaning that they answered the opinion questions with whatever facts they had in their head already about taxes, or 1 of 4 treatment groups, right? And so these are the people who answered some fact questions before they got to the opinion section. And here were those 4 groups. One set of respondents got a set of questions intended to emphasize that high-income people pay a lot in taxes. One group got a set of questions designed to make them think that high-income people pay little in taxes. One group of people got a set of questions that focused on taxes affecting low-income people and implied that low-income people pay a lot. And a last set of questions asked people about things that tend to be tax breaks for low-income people, so implying that poor people pay a little bit. Now, all of these facts are accurate, of course. I'm just drawing your attention to different parts of the tax code. So that looked like this. If I want to make you think that high-income people pay a lot in taxes, we can talk about marginal rates, right? If I want to make you think that low-income people pay a little in taxes, I can draw your attention to loopholes, right? If I want to make you think that low-income people pay a lot in taxes, we'll talk about grocery taxes. And at last, if I want to make you think that low-income people don't pay much in taxes, let's talk about the earned income tax credit, right, which is a refundable tax credit for low- to moderate-income families, right? So if I draw your attention to these different parts of the tax code, I might be able to change your ideas. Here's what we found. First of all, tax facts matter, and I thought that was great news, right? We could shift people's opinions by showing them different questions. But interestingly, at least for the Vox audience, questions about low-income people mattered more. The questions about high-income people didn't make much of a difference, and I'll show you that in a second. Secondly, tax fairness works like a seesaw, right? And I'll talk to you about what that means. And then finally, which is the little bit of the bleakest piece of news, ignorance might be bliss, right? We were talking at the beginning about the idea that what we want people to be is both informed about the taxpaying process and also happy. Those may not come together in one clean package. Okay, tax facts matter. So we asked several opinion questions, but I'm going to talk to you right now about people's assessment of their own tax fairness, right? So we gave them information about different parts of the tax code, and then we asked them whether they saw their own taxes as fair. And what you see here is the mean is 54%. 54% of people in any of the, combined together, 54% of the respondents thought that their taxes were fair. But if we showed you questions about low and or income people paying relatively high tax rates, so I talked to you about grocery taxes, that reduced people's sense of their own tax fairness. By contrast, if I talk to you about ways that low-income people get tax breaks, things like the earned income tax credit, that actually increased people's sense of their own tax fairness about 4% higher. And I should say that for a survey experiment, these are quite large effects. I spent the entire week very nervous we weren't going to see anything while we were running the experiment, but these are really quite noticeable effects. By contrast, higher-income people, whether I talk to you about them paying low taxes or high taxes, had relatively small impact. And I can talk to you a little bit about why, but let me go through the results. And we can talk about why I think maybe information about low-income taxpaying versus high-income taxpaying mattered. All right, fairness is a seesaw. Interestingly, if I focused your attention with these questions on taxes that make questions that make taxes on the poor seem high, people responded by thinking that taxes on the rich must be too low. Right? So you think one end's high, the other end must be low. I'll show you that in specific. Overall, 42% of Vox respondents in the control group, the ones who had not seen any extra facts, thought that high-income people pay too little in taxes. This is a bit higher than the American public as a whole, somewhere in the 60s it normally is, but Vox readers are unsurprisingly leaning a little on the left. So 82% of Vox respondents thought high-income people are not paying enough. That went up to 86% if I talked to you about loopholes and things like that, right? So I got an effect there, as you would expect. I talked to you about ways that low-income people or high-income people don't pay that much in taxes. You responded by thinking that high-income people should pay more. But I actually got not that much of a larger effect, but technically a larger effect if I talked to you not about what high-income people pay at all. I only talked to you with these questions about the taxes paid by low-income people. So people who got no extra information than they already came in with about high earners and their taxes. If I talked to you about things like the grocery tax, it made you think that even more than me talking directly about high earners, it made you think that rich people should pay more. All right, last point before I close out here. Ignorance might be bliss. All right, before we were talking about the difference in people's sense of fairness among these four groups, I've now added an extra bar, which is the control group, right? And what you can see is the bar on the left, which is the control group, had the highest assessments of fairness of any of the quizzes, right? So if I gave you no information about tax policy whatsoever, you thought taxes were more fair than if I gave you any information at all. Not great news, but there's some ways to think about this that I think are important. First of all, I gave you a very hard tax quiz. Right? Maybe people felt down because it was hard, even if they did well. Although I looked at people who did well, and they were not as happy as the control group either. But maybe just having to answer some hard questions, it put you in a little bit of a more negative mood, right? That's one thing. Or maybe it may be that the questions didn't make you think about taxes only. It made you think about income inequality. And so maybe you think everything's less fair if I've reminded you that very wealthy people are doing this or that very poor people are doing that, right? So it may be that these other considerations are the thing that really make the difference, right? But we should take into account the possibility that informing people and making people happy are not the same activity, right? All right, I want to talk quickly about the limitations, and we should talk more about this, but I should wrap up. Vox readers, you will be shocked to discover, are not a random sample of Americans, right? They are on average wealthier, more liberal, and the quiz takers, even though this is not true of the Vox readership as a whole, were substantially more male than female. And of course, the strangest thing about them is that they were willing to take a tax policy quiz. So, you know, this is an unusual group, right? And I actually, my instinct with it was that we were going to find pretty small effects, because these have to be people who are either very well informed about taxes or misinformed but sure that they know about taxes, right? But we got quite large effects. So the two main questions I have is, one, whether conservatives would respond differently, right? And I talked to you about how the low-income taxpayers, people liked finding out that low-income people don't pay much in taxes and were upset to find out that low-income people pay a lot in taxes, right? It lowered their sense of fairness, that second option. It might be that conservatives have a reverse view. It might be that conservatives are primarily in that group that think poor people should pay more in taxes that I showed you at the beginning. And so you might actually see a switch there. But I think the interesting thing is the possibility that most people don't think about taxes paid by low-income people at all, right? And so that's why you saw those things matter. People have pretty strong opinions about whether rich people need to pay more. That's a politically contested issue. People have a strong partisan view on it. People might not think as much about taxes that affect low-income people, right? So I think conservatives might respond differently, but I would still expect most of the difference to come at the low-income side of the spectrum. Finally, would less engaged people respond differently? As I told you, I was worried we weren't going to see enough of an effect because these are people with strong opinions. I still think that in a group with less strongly held opinions, you might even see a larger effect. But that's a hypothesis. So my next step is definitely to run a sort of similar survey experiment. Not as much of a quiz and not as cute of graphics because I'm not Vox, but a similar kind of experiment in a nationally representative sample. And actually, I've begun doing that now. That's being fielded starting this week. So I will be able to report back to you more information about this kind of question in a few months. Thank you very much.
Ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks for the presentation. That was, I think, very informative. And the results you get out of the survey bring a bunch of questions to mind. So I just want to go through a couple of them, and then we'll turn it over to the crowd for additional ones. As you mentioned, just about everybody who's economically active in the population files a tax return. And that means they interact with their government at least once a year when they complete this tax return. Mm-hmm. What are, like, the top words or phrases that describe how people feel about that interaction?
So I think that people have several conflicting ideas in their head when they're thinking about taxes. One is that people see being a taxpayer as an important part of their civic obligations. It's part of being a good citizen. And you will recognize this in sort of popular speech. How often have you heard someone say, well, I pay my taxes. I'm a taxpayer. And, you know, and this is strange because it describes basically literally anyone engaging in a market economy. It's sort of a funny place to put your chips, right? But people in America in particular see tax paying as something that is evidence of being a good citizen, right? Someone who contributes to their community. So that's one consideration people have when they're paying their taxes. Of course, the other, and so it's a little bit about who's in their community and who's out, right? Because what they want is to be able to pay taxes to support their community. But some of us don't see that everyone in America should be part of our community, right? So there's that tension. The other tension, of course, is attitudes about the government, right? And whether you think the government is behaving correctly with your taxes. So unfortunately, the federal income tax, while on the one hand it is this direct interaction with government, which I think is really important for people to have as citizens, right? The opportunity to recognize the government plays an important role in their lives and that they should be able to judge the quality of that government and respond to it because this is a democracy. But the information they get from the tax-paying process is not always very positive, right? Because this is an arcane process. This is confusing. Also, people often have very negative ideas about the IRS and sort of this, which the IRS sort of becomes a symbol of government overreach and government's intrusion into your life, right? So on the one hand, they have this very positive view, which is why I call my book Why Americans Are Proud to Pay Taxes, because they see tax paying as this important civic responsibility. On the other hand, the federal income tax paying process draws people's attention to the confusion of government, the lack of clarity, and particularly the idea that wealthier people or people with special fancy lawyers can look at this tax form and make magic occur and not pay any taxes while I look at it and get confused and worried, right? So it gives them a sense that maybe government doesn't work equally for everyone.
And so one point that you made in the presentation was this idea that on the one hand, we sometimes think about people who are participating in a tax system as almost being like part of a purchasing co-op, right? We put money in and we get some goods and services out. Mm-hmm. And then you mentioned the experiment the Obama administration did with the tax receipt. Mm-hmm. And you said that the evidence was a little mixed as to what the value of that was. Do people really not know what they're purchasing? And given that information, does that help them?
So, yes, there are. I focused primarily on the tax side, but on the spending side, there is, of course, massive misinformation in terms of where tax money goes, right? As a general rule, people feel very good about money that's spent locally, that they can see in their communities that has a physical presence. So, roads, schools, hospitals, you know, bridges, all infrastructure, and then to the extent they remember it, things like the sewer system and clean water. If they recall those things, they really like them, but they don't always remember all those things, right? So that's what's really popular. Then at the very bottom, the least popular things are two things: anything that might, you know, bailouts, corporate aid, corporate tax breaks. No one ever mentions those except to say they don't like them. And then foreign aid is the other thing that basically no one mentions unless they don't like it. And I should be clear that when many people talk about foreign aid, they do not mean what policymakers mean by foreign aid, which is a very limited part of the budget. They see a sort of blurrier line between official foreign aid and foreign military interventions that are described in humanitarian terms. So people do hugely overestimate the foreign aid budget, but that overestimation is not as large as you think, because people are also, they're not really clear on where the line is between the foreign aid that goes to a place like Afghanistan and the military investment that goes to a place like Afghanistan. And that, to some extent, is reasonable, right? That's not, it's a clear line in the budget, but it's not a clear line probably on the ground, and it's certainly not a clear line from, you know, the sort of average viewer's perspective. So people have misconceptions about, and then there's the sort of third category, which is what you might think of as most of the welfare state, right? So this is healthcare, this is aid to the poor, also military spending to some extent is a kind of mixed bag for people. And so on those things, you really find, first of all, partisan divides, and you also find a far more focus on aid to the poor than is really in line with the budgetary cost of those things. Because, like, separating out Social Security and Medicare, which are seen differently by the public, but sort of what most people in the public might describe as welfare, but we would describe as a bunch of separate programs that are means-tested, those things come in for more attention than anything else, including roads and schools, and have people have very mixed feelings about.
And so, change gears a little bit. In the olden days, people would sit at their kitchen table with a pencil and paper and do their tax return by hand. Now, half people go to a paid preparer, another third use software. Mm-hmm. Does that change the basic experience of paying taxes?
My instinct is that it definitely does. I wish that I could have been there recording the data along the way to actually demonstrate this.
You're not nowhere near old enough.
I'm afraid so. But the... You know, one of the things that I think, so marginal rates are very poorly understood. The idea that your income is taxed only above the bracket of the income below a bracket is taxed at that bracket level, income above a bracket level is taxed at a new rate, but it doesn't apply to your whole income. That is very poorly understood. But back when you had to look it up in a table, it's possible that would have been clearer. Now, it's not completely certain, but I think that that's one thing that may have gotten lost a little bit when you know, you just type some numbers into software and it spits out an answer and you need to send in $100 or you get $100 back or whatever it is. You lose a little bit of that connection to what rates mean and what, you know, and the extent to which rates matter as well, I think. Yeah.
So one thing the Tax Policy Center spent a fair amount of time on over the years is the alternative minimum tax. Mm-hmm. And if you go back to the pencil and paper days, it would be almost impossible for someone to comply with the alternative minimum tax. That way. Now, on software, using software, you put a bunch of information in, and an answer spits out without you ever having to navigate your way through that.
Right.
Does that affect the way people feel about the complexity of a provision?
Yeah, and definitely, I think that having it be sort of a black box is not great for democratic accountability, and I think it's not great for people's sense of how these things work. Particularly because it's all mediated, through, your accountant or some software. It's not even, the government part of it becomes less and less visible, I think, over time. I think that is a real challenge for people to identify, particularly when we try and do social policy through the tax code, for people to identify what things benefit them. And I think that's a real problem, and a bunch of other scholars have made this point, too, that, when Social Security is clear to people because you get a check, right? You start doing things, distantly through, like manipulating the economy, which might be the efficient way to have particular benefits occur. If people can't identify those benefits and support them, then the democratic process isn't really operating the way you'd like it to, right? So, yeah, I think that's very problematic.
And so based on your work, when people file their taxes, do they try to do the right thing? Like you have 80 or 90% of people saying that, you know, it's important to pay your fair share. Mm-hmm. So do they try to do the right thing, or do they maybe misreport a little bit so that they reduce their taxes, but they don't misreport enough that they, like, call an audit upon themselves? So do they, you know, what do they try to do?
Well, I think, I mean, most people have almost no impact on how their taxes get done because they work for wages or salary and it's withheld, and they, you know, there's not great room to maneuver if what you wanted to do was avoid paying your taxes. Frankly, it's quite difficult for salaried employees, I think, to do that. And I mean, remember, most people don't even itemize, right? So there's not much room for most people to have much impact on their own tax compliance at the end of the day. I think that I found a variety of attitudes, right? And I can't apply, I'm not being the IRS, I cannot actually interpret whether people are telling me accurately about their taxpaying experiences, right? There were a small number of people who saw the taxpaying process as a puzzle that they liked to solve, right? This is not personally my attitude. I found it very hard to understand. But that, you know, that this was like, I'm going to try and think through all the ways that I can put in all my and not to do anything illegal by any stretch of the imagination, but they like to think the process through and find all the ways to sort of win at what they felt was like a game, right? Far more common than that attitude, I have found, is just wanting to get it done and get it done right and have it be over, right? That was by far the most common reaction. And particularly, you know, because when people file their own taxes, they have to remember what they think of in a sort of general category as their loopholes. And that's true at every income level because of things like the earned income tax credit, the child tax credit. You have to remember these very specific provisions that will make a big difference for you, right? Remembering your EITC makes a big difference for you. Remembering your home mortgage makes a big difference for your taxes, right? You don't have to remember or even think at all about rates. So unfortunately, one of the impacts of that is that it leaves people thinking that loopholes are the only thing that matter for the tax code, and they discount the effect of the graduated income tax. But the graduated income tax is, of course, very important. It achieves quite a lot of progressivity, particularly compared to other countries, right? So I think that people filing their income taxes, I think the most common opinion is just to want to get it done right and have it be done. And but the experience reminds them that tax paying is a game that can be played, and there's someone out there playing it better, and that's unfair.
So in terms of the tax administration agency, you talked a little bit about tax morale and how an improvement in tax morale could lead to improvement in compliance. What are the two or three things that the tax administrator, like the IRS, could do to improve tax morale in the United States?
Well, I certainly think that to the extent that you can make it easier for people to file their income taxes, you are making Americans a lot happier, right? Because as I said, people confuse hassle and cost. Mm-hmm. And the income tax is a hassle. And for many people, it needn't be, really, because their taxes are very, very simple from an administrator's perspective, but very, very complicated from an individual perspective, right? So that's one thing. Another thing that I think, and this is something I've been sort of trying to maybe test out, is giving people the opportunity, when they file their taxes, to also remind them, oh, do you need to update your voter registration? Have you registered to vote? Right? Because, as you mentioned right at the beginning, there's this huge gap between the percentage of people who file their taxes and the percentage of people who vote. Now, obviously, there are people who file taxes who shouldn't vote, right? But they also go to the DMV and get, you know, their driver's license and are reminded, oh, but do you want to register to vote, right? So I think, like motor voter, we could have something like filer voter, right? Because you're already interacting with government. You're already filling out a form. You're already thinking about how government matters to you, right? You're either getting a refund that year or you're paying in. You're reminded that government's very important for your daily life. And whether you're angry or happy about that, it's a great time in my estimation. It would be a great time to remind people that they have a say. Not a big say, but a very small say, but a say in the policies that are affecting their lives, right? So to me, what I would love to see, and I'm going to attempt to do this experimentally in the next year, is test out whether reminding people to register to vote in the spring helps them actually get out there and make decisions about the country that they live in the fall.
And so one last question on this. When you talked a little bit about the connection of filing a tax return to voting in this case. We've seen a lot of people in the financial literacy side of the world want to connect the time of tax filing with other things, like signing up for a retirement account, saving, doing something like that. How effective are those those activities?
I mean, I think there's been mixed success. Some have shown real success, and some are less so. And I mean, one of the challenges is particularly, you know, there's been a lot of economic uncertainty mm-hmm. in the last few years, so people are in a different position in terms of their capacity to save. When economic uncertainty is high, certain things become harder for people. But I think in general, it's clearly, you know, a lot of people want to use this moment because it's an unusual moment. You're thinking about your finances, you're thinking about your government, and while of course the process should be easier and better, I would not want to eliminate there being a couple of days out of the year where Americans think about these questions, right? I would like it to be a time where they have better information to work with, better information to use to make these important financial and political decisions, right? But I wouldn't want it to just disappear at all, right? I think this is a moment that we should be harnessing to improve not only people's financial health, but also their capacity to act as citizens.
Well, I'm enjoying this conversation, but I think I should maybe let other people enter it as well. So I'd like to open things up for questions from the audience. If you have a question, just raise your hand, and we'll try to get a microphone over to you. So we have a question up here in the front.
Hi, I'm Len Berman. You talked a little bit about compliance and the fact that wage and salary workers obviously can't underreport their income and get away with it, and we see the compliance is very high for them. Compliance is very low for self-employed people, and the IRS Congress has been cutting the IRS's budget for decades now, and the audit rates are really, really low. Mm-hmm. If people see taxes and as a civic responsibility, could politicians actually win public support by actually pushing more audits to get people who are known to be prone to noncompliance to pay more, to pay their fair share?
I think this is a critical question. The public vision of the IRS was so strange. In my interviews, the public vision of the IRS is very strange. Because on the one hand, people who had actually interacted with the IRS had views ranging from, I would say, annoyance to genuine surprise that they'd been really helpful. That was the range of views, right? But they were not particularly bold views. They were like, oh, yes, I did have to call and ask about X, Y, or Z thing this one time. But when people talked about the IRS in principle, or writ large, let's say, several people referred to them as the men in black in my interview. I mean, there's a vision of what the IRS is symbolically. Several people would say, and I know I'm being, I'm being extreme here. I know this isn't accurate, but when you ask me about the IRS, what I think of is the men in black. And so the IRS becomes a sort of symbol of a government that works on behalf of someone else and has unfair leverage over you, the little people, right? And I think that that's so terrible for how we run our, for fiscal policy, but more broadly for the country as a whole. I think absolutely, underfunding the IRS really undercuts people's capacity to have faith in this critical shared value, right? So when we make it seem more arbitrary than it is, and when we make it seem like these rules aren't being applied fairly or that the rules themselves are unfair, I think it's really dangerous. And so one of the problems is that if you actually did things that were practically better, that you audited more in particular categories or whatever, I think it would be very difficult to get that information through to the public because you're operating with this idea of what the agency is that's so... it's funny, people would admit that vision of the agency was probably quite unfair, and actually probably it was just mostly people working in their offices trying to do the right thing. But like the vision of the agency is so negative. I think it'd be really hard to get facts through that sort of symbolism.
Right? Okay, another question right behind Len.
Okay, maybe it's a two-part question. Most Americans, when they file a tax time, are getting money back from the IRS. They're not paying. So one is kind of, how do people's perceptions of what they pay depend on how much they pay a tax time or how much their actual tax payments are over the year? And the sort of related question is, when they get refunds, do they distinguish between refunds that come because withholding is coming back or refunds that come from something like the earned income tax credit?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. I found, to take your second part first, I found mixed results on that. People who got a lot back tended to know. In fact, they saw it as something like a savings account. Several surveys I've run have asked about people's perceptions of the earned income tax credit, whether they've ever received it. I have to use their demographics to assess whether it's likely that they did receive the EITC, right? But people I found were generally pretty accurate about that. It was typically low to moderate income people with children or adult children who remembered having received this credit. And a lot of them saw it as a moment when they could, you know, catch up on bills that had accrued over winter, especially if you live somewhere that's cold, so they had, like, utility bills, or they would sort of set that money aside for college savings or something like this. So that people, at the lower end, I thought that that was something that people really did recognize was a benefit. But I think if you're more near the edge where it's not a large benefit, I think it's probably less clear to you, right? And one thing that I know that is done, and I don't know how systematically it's done, but I know that it's done at least enough that it shows up in interviews, is people try and get as much withheld as possible so that check at the end of the year is as big as possible, right? So they really are using it as a method of savings, which might not be most maximally economically efficient, but also when you're taking into account for people who are living very near their full income, the idea of having to come up with $250 all of a sudden would be really painful. So they'd much rather just end up getting a very large check all at once and be absolutely totally confident that they have not, you know, they haven't even put on the form that they have children, you know, so that it's a really large check that they're getting at the end of the year. So I think that for people for whom the EITC is a important financial thing that gets them through the year, people tend to be aware that they're getting money back, and it's not just that the amount they paid in. It's more less clear at the margins. And then I found that it's not entirely obvious for people who aren't receiving EITC that is refundable. That was not always clear. Some people knew that, but many people did not. You just thought you got your money back, right? I knew I would forget the first part of the question. I knew it.
The amount they pay totally, the amount they get with it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a lot. I think there's a, you know, people. So let me give you an example of a particular person, which I think sort of captures. This is a woman who was very good with her own budget, right? And it's very rare, I think, for people want to do math on the spot in conversation. Even I don't like doing that. But this was a woman who we were talking about various parts of the time. She was a low-income woman, received the EITC, knew she was getting EITC, and knew that next year she was going to buy a dryer. She was prepared for when she was getting that money back, right? Had two kids. And working several part-time jobs to make it all hold together. And so she was quite good at math, and so I had at one point actually asked her, you know, for instance, because she was working out percentages in her head, I was like, have you ever thought about how much you pay in grocery taxes, because she lives in a state that had grocery taxes. And she worked out that math on top of her head, right? But so this was someone who's, by any standard, mathematically perfectly competent. When I asked her whether she thought tax rates should be progressive or like a flat tax, she said, oh, I think a flat tax would be fairer, but then what you get back should be based on your income. Now, that's a really, I mean, and I see the logic. I see it, you know, that you're like, okay, there'd be a flat amount of tax taken out from everyone, and then you would get some, your refund, in some sense, would be based on. So I think that there is some confusion around this issue, even among people with relatively genuinely quite high mathematical aptitudes. So yeah, I think that that is a source of confusion for sure.
We got a gentleman in the red and then the woman in front. We'll get you next.
Thank you very much, Larry Checco. I wonder how much language has to play in all of this. For example, we see taxes as a burden. What if people started to see taxes as an investment in their country rather than as a burden? And it would be up to the government to figure out the ROI. Am I getting a good return on my investment? But I think on the issue of fairness, I think why people get really upset about the tax system is that you have a president, for example, take a little politics, who wants to pay as little tax as he can, and he's driving around in a big plane. Now, that's an extreme example, but my point is that why do I want to let people who don't want to pay their fair share in taxes drive on my roads, go to my public schools, play in my public parks, breathe my clean air, go on and on, you know, drink my clean water. I'm paying my taxes for that. And I want to know, make sure that there's a, if not, go to the Cayman Islands and live. Thank you.
Or Mar-a-Lago.
Or Mar-a-Lago.
Yeah, I think there's several important things I want to follow up with on that. One is, a survey question that I've asked a few times now is, what percentage of U.S. adults do you think are taxpayers? Now, Okay, there's some people, perhaps people like living within institutions, maybe really don't interact with the market economy, but like to an or, you know, more or less, almost everyone's a taxpayer in some sense of the term, right? Who's an adult, whoever buys anything, puts gas in their car, has a job, owns property, all of these things make you a taxpayer. So you find that there's a spike at 50% for Republicans, right? People see that statistic about 47% of Americans don't pay a federal income tax. Gets sort of remembered as half of Americans don't pay taxes. But even among Democrats, the average percentage of people they saw as taxpayers was somewhere between 60 and 70%. So that is a substantial sort of gap, right, between how many people are at the end of the day paying some sort of taxes and sort of the symbolic resonance of being a taxpayer and therefore, you know, sort of paying your federal income tax is the tax that really counts, makes you a taxpayer, right? And what's interesting is that Even among just conservative Republicans, right, people who estimated the taxpaying population to be smaller were vastly more likely to, when I asked an open-ended question, what upsets you about government spending, when I asked you that open-ended question, they were vastly more likely to either say welfare or name a means-tested program, right? And the larger they thought the taxpaying population, the less likely they were to name a means-tested program as something they dislike. So I think people are operating with that sense that, you know, if I don't think you're chipping in, no, you don't deserve to benefit from the things that we're all supposed to be paying for together, right? Now, on the first point about Donald Trump, I actually think this is a really interesting political moment because it's not that common for, although there's a fair amount of sort of anti-tax rhetoric in political talk in general, and the Republican Party certainly is at a very strong policy platform about lowering the income tax, disliking the income tax for a very long time. The idea that you personally, as a candidate, are going to say that you try and pay as little as possible and that it's smart not to pay, that's actually an unusual piece of rhetoric that's out of keeping with tradition in the Republican Party. So one question that, traditionally speaking, when I showed you that chart of everyone being up near the top on civic duty, right, that's Republicans and Democrats, actually, traditionally, Republicans are more likely to say that taxpaying is a moral responsibility than Democrats, more likely to say civic duty, right? So an interesting question for me is whether the data coming out in the next year or so will show that flipping. Now, I don't think it'll make a huge difference because you're up near the top anyway, so the differences are small, right? You're talking about a couple percentage points here. But I think that traditionally speaking, Republicans are more likely to assert taxpaying is a civic responsibility than Democrats, and it's possible you'll see some shift there with the sort of prominence of the president's recent rhetoric on the subject.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's possible that with a national survey, you might find that people who are more Republican think that poor people pay too little taxes, and people who are more Vox type think that rich people don't pay enough taxes.
Right.
But my question is actually about undocumenteds,
mm-hmm.
who most of whom pay taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And often they're paying it with a false Social Security number.
Mm-hmm.
And what that really means is that they will never recover any part of that tax payment, that's cush to the government of whatever. And I wonder if there's a way to factor in to the discussion the fact that that it's possible that undocumenteds are actually paying a disproportionately high unrefundable taxes.
So to talk a little bit about that, that's certainly the case. A lot of undocumented people are using false or someone else's Social Security number and contributing substantially, I mean, billions of dollars to the Social Security reserves. And of course, like everyone else, you pay sales tax because you are a resident, all these other taxes. And of course, to the extent that undocumented people tend to be lower income, which I think is probably likely to be true, they're going to be paying a higher percentage in sales tax than higher income people, same as any other person who's lower income pays a higher percentage of their income in sales tax than other taxes. So that's absolutely factually the case. And you are absolutely right to think that it is misunderstood by the public. People tend to think that first of all, for many people, there's a sort of blurry line between undocumented immigrants, recent immigrants of an ethnicity about whom I'm uncomfortable. Like there's a blurry line there. And so when I was talking before about taxpaying as a way of contributing to your community, it's also a way of defining the limits of your community. you see this a little bit with foreign aid, right? Like, we're raising tax money here, and it's going to those people over there who are not our community. That's not where tax money should go. It's certainly not where tax money should be prioritized, a very common way of thinking, right? So I think sort of implicit in your question is whether giving people better information about the taxpaying reality of immigrants in general, who, of course, pay tax like everyone else, but undocumented immigrants in particular who are contributing to Social Security, will change.
And they're paying withholding.
Right, yeah. Right.
So you're talking about withholding.
So yeah, and so I think that some people have tried to work out the numbers on this about what percentage people are having their tax withheld versus being paid. And then, of course, people also, you can file your income taxes even if you don't have withholding, and that some people do that too as part of there are certainly immigrant groups who have worked to encourage people to do that so as to demonstrate how long they've been in the country and that they have been contributing their taxes during this time. So this is definitely a very active issue. My question is whether sharing those facts with people who have negative views of immigrants and undocumented immigrants in particular would change minds. And I, while I would like to believe that that is true, I am somewhat skeptical because I think, as we were talking before about the IRS, I think that when you have a strong symbolism or emotional reaction to something, when someone comes at you with some facts about it, it's rare that those change your views. It's not impossible, but it's a real challenge. And I think, and I should say that it's a challenge for all of us, right? That this is, whenever we're outside of our comfort zone on an issue that is not our expertise and we have a strong emotional feeling about what's true, someone coming at you with some facts tends, they bounce off us a little bit as human beings, right? So I think it's a real challenge that while that's factually true, I wish I had more confidence that it would make a difference to public attitudes, that the difference that you would like it to see, right?
A question in the middle of the room here.
Hi, Donald Myers. I have a question about tax reform. Over the years, there's been lots of proposals from one on a continuum. The most extreme case would be eliminate all deductions, have people fill out a postcard with their income and send it into the IRS. Sounds very simple. Any research done about what their perception of that would be? Would that be a good thing? Would people be concerned and worried that various tax benefits they view as benefits, like the mortgage deduction, would be taken away, even though it's questionable value to the public as well as individual taxpayers?
Right. So I think I should start by saying that people, I said at the beginning that people don't have a good sense of how taxes affect people across the income distribution. Tax expenditures and what would be casually called loopholes are even worse understood. So things like the home mortgage interest deduction, the regressivity of that benefit is absolutely beyond the scope of what most people understand about the impact of that policy. Not to say that no one understands it. There are very educated people who do, but that's not well understood. So this is a good example of when you do social policy through the tax code, it makes it very hard for people to judge that. In fact, they've done surveys where if you tell people the overall impact of the home mortgage interest deduction, if you tell people the overall impact, they become much less fond of it, right? As a policy, because they don't like that overall impact, even if they like it personally. But the challenge, I think, with tax reform in general is that the details of policies are hard for people to understand. There is a strong incentive for political actors to mislead people. People do not have a good ballast, is how I think of it, like on a boat, to keep them steady, right? So the less information they have, the easier it is to be swayed by the political winds. And one thing people dislike very much on the subject of taxation is uncertainty. So major tax changes are immediately suspect and very reasonable at the end of the day, right? If you don't feel confident that you understand tax policy as it stands now, I think it is quite reasonable to think that major tax reform is something that makes you quite uncomfortable, right? So I think that one of the things that matters a lot for tax reform is the political moment, right? And the capacity to get sort of a unified consensus among elite figures that this, they're going to be winners and losers, but this is in general good for us, right? It also helps to have a budget surplus, I think, probably to be working with to make that comfortable for folks. But the political moment matters a great deal, and we do not exist in a political moment right now where, first of all, elite consensus across parties is likely, and secondly, where there's a high level of trust either in government as a whole or in the other party's intentions. And all of those things, because people don't have a lot of facts to be working with on things like tax reform, all of those things really undermine confidence So it makes it very, very challenging. Now, I think that on the specific question of having, there has been work done looking at would people like it to get their income tax forms filled out. I think that does tend to appeal to people, right? Some percentage of people would want to, you know, as long as there were the option of being able to do your own taxes also, right? Then I think if you had no say and couldn't revise the government's estimates, obviously I think that would be very upsetting for people. But, you know, if you're given the option of filling out your taxes, but also you could just get the form filled out for you, here it is, I think that has polled very well with people. I think they talked about it in California for a while, and it was quite a positive idea. But this is the big challenge of trying to conduct any major tax change in a time when trust in government is low and trust between parties is very low. And that it makes all of these things very challenging.
Okay. Well, Vanessa, thank you very much for a very good conversation.
It's been great.
I think it's been very valuable for the audience here and the audience watching via webcast. So join me, everybody, in thanking Vanessa for...